Thank you so much to Mocha for sponsoring this video and making it possible. I think that personal apps are one of the most underrated use cases of vibe coding. And in this video, I'm going to show you exactly how to use Mocha to build your own personal app. Now, a personal app is an app that solves your own unique problem. So the personal app for me in this video is a workout tracking app that's unique to my use cases, but for you, it might be something different. But regardless of what you want to create, you are going to see how to do it in this video. Let's jump in. So I am going to design a fitness tracking dashboard with workout logs and progress charts. It's already working here, as you can see. In a second, you're going to see what it generates on the first generation. And in the prompt, I'm saying I want to make it look really slick and clean in a dark theme. And I'm going to say use mock data so we can get a visual feel for it. And because Mocha has a real database built in, so up at the top, you can see build code data. This is the database. We're going to be able to add our own real data. So it's not just going to be mock data, but it's nice to start with mock data so that way we can see what it looks like without it being completely empty. And then I'm going to continue adding on features that I think would be great for a personal workout tracker for me. You're going to see how customizable and powerful Mocha is. And at the end of the video, I think you're going to have an idea for your own personal app that you want to use and you want to build using Mocha. Click the link in the description to go to Mocha and try out Mocha for yourself after the video. While Mocha is building our first version, I'm going to go through and show you around Mocha. So up at the top, we have the code tab. So here you can actually see all of the code. If you are technical, you can go in and look at everything that's there. You can even download the code if you want, which you'll be able to do once this initial version is actually generated. But if you are not technical, you don't ever have to go into the code tab. You can do everything on the build tab and the settings, and you really don't even need to go into the data tab if you're not technical either. So the data tab is where your database is going to be generated, but it is helpful even if you're not technical to know that you can go in here and see all of the data that is inside of your app. Something really nice about Mocha that I actually haven't seen on many other vibe coding platforms is that you can go from your development database to a production database. So you are not locked into one database here. You're going to have a development database, which you can have dummy data, which you can kind of play around with. And then your production app. So once you hit publish, the link there is going to be on the production database. And that is for your published app. That's really helpful, especially as you're making changes to your app and want to have two separate databases there. Then under settings, and in a second, we're going to see what Mocha has actually created. You have a lot of things that you can change here in the settings. One thing that I really like is the share preview here. So you can customize what this looks like when you share your project. You can upload assets here, or you can upload them directly in the build tab. You can publish and add your own custom domain. You can have API keys. So this is if you want to build something a little bit more complicated. So let's say I wanted AI functionality in my app, and we could get our API key from OpenAI, add it here in the secrets, and then we would be able to connect to OpenAI or any other service that has an API that we want to connect with. Google Sign-In allows us to have user authentication right out of the box, and it's through Google, which I really like. It's a one-click sign-up. I think that especially if you're building apps for other people, I think that Google Sign-In is the best user authentication. I really like it. And then you can even have a custom knowledge base so that the AI assistant knows things about your, you know, writing style preferences, company terminology, things like that. So let's jump back into the build tab. And it looks like we have our first version ready to check out. So as we can see, we have our web app that it generated. It looks really nice and sleek. We have mock data throughout. I'm actually curious if I go to the data tab. So it looks like the mock data is just fully built into the code. It didn't actually create mock data in the database. So that'll be the next thing that we do, which will be pretty fun, is adding, telling it to create the actual database. It looks like it has personal vests, recent workouts, cardio, strength, HIIT, etc. And then let's test the log workout functionality. So that actually is not working yet either. And the profile isn't working yet either. So basically, it just created this mockup dashboard, which on its own can be great. So let's say you're a UI designer for a startup, or you're a founder and you want to build mockups. You don't need it to be fully functional. You could just use this, publish it, share it with others, and then just have this be, hey, what do you think of this dashboard? It doesn't have to be fully functional. But the power of vibe coding is that it's actually pretty easy to make it functional. And that can be great whether you want to build a personal app like this video or even for a functional mockup to share with others. So let's send another prompt here. And I want to start making this functional. So I'm going to say, make it functional by letting me log a workout. So here we can see it's going to add a form with workout type, duration, exercises, and notes. And you'll be able to add multiple exercises dynamically and save workouts in the history. So here I'm wondering if it's also going to build out the data tab and add database tables, or if it's just going to still be that mockup on the front end. So we'll see what happens. And then by the end of the video, we are going to add that data tab for sure. So you're going to want to stick around. And there's also some really cool features I'm going to add here that I think might surprise you that Mocha can generate, and especially how easily it can generate. So you're going to want to stick around for that as well. While it's generating this feature, I want to show you two advanced features of Mocha that are really crucial for you to use, especially if there's any bugs that you need to work with the AI assistant to debug and fix. So first, there's this button here for the logs. So the logs are basically showing you what's happening as users use the app. So if there's any bugs and you click a button and it doesn't work, for example, it's going to show an error message in the log. You could copy that error message, paste it into the chat. There's also something really helpful here, which is restart sandbox. So if you're ever getting an error, it's not working, it can be helpful to go in and restart the sandbox. And that basically just resets the sandbox where your app is being shown. And sometimes that resolves bugs as well. But those are two things that you should know about. You also can use the discuss mode. If there's a bug, to chat. You can chat without it actually making changes. If this is turned off, it's pretty much always or usually going to take what you say and start coding. So that could be helpful as well. All right, so let's test this out. It says it's fully functional. If I go into the database now, we still do not have the data being saved. So that'll be the next thing we do. But let's test it out. If I click log workout, strength, we can say 45 minutes, calories burned, 200 exercises. So you can add this in. So let's say bench press and 3, 10, 135. So let's go ahead and submit the workout. And now it is saved. Here it is. Recent workout, bench press, 3x10, 135. Okay, great. But if we refresh the page, it's not going to show up because this was all on the front end. So now I'm going to say, great. Can we add a backend to this? So the data is actually saved. Also add user authentication. So the data is unique per person. So this is where Mocha is going to be really powerful. And it does it really easily, is adding in that user authentication. That means user authentication basically means a user is signing in. Looks like I hit a Mocha. This is just a Mocha survey that they're serving me. But yeah, user authentication is basically another way of saying users signing into your app. When a user signs in, they can have data that is specifically connected to their account. So that means that I can log in, see my workouts, and you can log in and see your workouts. So that's what user authentication is. If you're not using Mocha, you would have to connect to something like Supabase or Firebase to add user authentication in. A lot of vibe coding platforms are working on building this in all in one. For example, Lovable has something called Lovable Cloud to build that in all in one. Base44 has something like this as well. But something that differentiates Mocha, like I mentioned before, is that it has that Google sign-in by default, which I really like, as opposed to email and password. So it's going to add user authentication, add a backend database to persist workout data. Now, if we go to the data tab, we can see we had exercises and workouts as tables, and then we can see all the data types that it created for each table as well. And something else that's cool is I can even see by reading here, it says it fixed TypeScript errors by adding proper type checks for the authenticated user in the API endpoints. Now, you don't have to know what that means, but you know that it fixed an error. And it did that on its own. So we did not have to test out the app, see that there's an error. Now, of course, sometimes that is going to happen. But in this case, the AI assistant knew that there was an error in the code and it resolved it on its own. This is what I think makes AI coding and vibe coding so exciting, is the AI starting to really kind of do iterations and improving on the code without humans having to test every step along the way. Okay, here we are. We have our new little landing page here. And we could have it build out a better landing page if you wanted this to be an app that other people were going to use. But let's test this out. I'm going to click Get Started. And again, as we mentioned, sign in with Google. So let's go ahead and do that. So we're logged in. There's no workouts in the history, but it is showing personal best records. I think that is an error, because let me go into the database. There are no exercises and no workouts. So that right off the bat, before we log a workout to test the database, I'm going to say the database is empty, but I see recent personal bests. That should be cleared. Okay, I'm going to send that. I know I made spelling errors, but the nice thing about AI is that it knows what I meant, even with spelling errors. So it's going to remove that section because there's no real data, and it's only going to show when we have actual workout data logged. So it's going to take care of that for us. I think that is kind of funny how in AI, with AI vibe coding tools or whatever, even if you're chatting with ChatGPT, like you generally, if you make spelling mistakes, it knows what you meant. You don't have to necessarily go back and fix the spelling. So here it is reasoning. It's using reasoning models. Now, one thing with Mocha is that you do not get to choose the model that the AI is using. Mocha, we actually have a video with the CEO of Mocha. We talked about this. Their goal is to make Mocha the best platform it can be. So they're using really powerful models in the back end, but you don't have to think about it as the user. And their philosophy is you shouldn't have to think about as a user which model to use. It should just work. So that's the ultimate goal here. All right, so now it's not showing that, which is correct. So let's test it out. Let's log a workout. Let's say it's cardio. 60 minutes, calories burned. I don't know if I would always know that information, so I might tweak this and start removing certain things, but I'll keep it for now. So let's say exercise is, you know, treadmill. Reps aren't really applicable. So that would be another thing, is for cardio, we might want to change how this is. Like it would be more so like time or distance. Just make some notes here on the left side. I'm not going to send it yet. I'm going to say for workout types like cardio, sets and reps don't make sense. Should be distance, etc. Then I'm going to send that. So here we go. We can see the treadmill is there and it just says 60 minutes and then it's not showing the other data, which is great because it's not there. But then I'm going to send this off. But then in the data tab, we should just be able to double check that, yep, the exercise is showing, workouts is showing, which is good. So now the data is associated with me as the user and it's all saving in the database. Now, as I mentioned before, this is the development database. So once we publish the app, it's going to then be in the production database instead of the development database. So there's two different databases. Okay, so it's going to update the workout logging form to show appropriate fields based on the workout type, distance for cardio, sets for reps, weight for strength training. And I'm curious, should it do that for other, like yoga? It should probably do that as well. Sports, it did change it at least a little bit for sports. HIIT. So yeah, it might need a little bit more tweaking, but I'm curious to see what it does, at least for cardio and strength. So it looks like I actually already did it, even though it's still working here. So we go to cardio now. We can see activity and distance. Okay, so it says it updated if we go to log workout. Now, if we switch to cardio, we can see that distance. See what it did for yoga? It just has exercise names, sets, reps, weight. So again, it doesn't fully apply for those, but I'll keep it for now. And we can always make changes about that in the future. So why don't we go ahead and actually publish this app? And I'm going to show you what that looks like. So first of all, you can manage the URL. I can make the default URL like my workout app. And let's see if anyone has used that. It looks like they haven't because it let me do it. So now I am publishing the app under myworkoutapp.mocha.app. And once it's published, anyone on the internet would be able to go to that specific URL and access the app, or I can use it just as my own personal app. Here it is, myworkoutapp.mocha.app. I can copy that link and it would go to that. Here we are on the production version. So I'm going to log in again. So I just logged in. I logged in with the same email, seth@nocode.mba. Now, the difference is we are on the production database. So this is what I mean. There is no data in here, even though we have already logged the workout. And I'm going to show you in a second what that looked like in the database. But why don't we go and just do strength, since the other one was cardio. Let's just say 25 minutes, 200. We could do exercise of, you know, chest press, 3, 10, 100. And I'll say this felt great. I'm going to save the workout. So here it's all showing up here. And then I'm going to go back. And now I'm back in Mocha. And I'm going to go to the data tab. And now I can show you here in development, we can see there's that treadmill workout that we did. If I switch to the production database, it has the user that we just created. And now exercises, we can see the chest press, and then workouts, we can see the strength workout that we did. So this is what I mean by the production database and development database are two totally different databases. The information in the production database is completely independent from the information in the development database. So if we go back to the build tab, and if we make changes here, it will not update the production app. So the myworkedoutapp.mocha.app, this is the production app. Again, as I mentioned before, you can add a custom domain to this. So it does not have to just be myworkoutapp.mocha.app, but it won't show up on the production app until we publish. So we can make changes here and it won't show up until we hit that publish. So I'm just saying, let's add a quick add workout feature for exercises. I want to be able to start a workout and then add exercises as I go. So in a second, we're going to see what it generated. It said that it's going to let me do this with a live timer and the ability to save when I'm done. So I'm curious how it's going to actually implement this. All right, so the feature is done. It's here on development. Now, again, just to show you what I mean, if I open up the production version, that feature is not there yet until we actually hit publish. So if I click start workout, here we can put to cardio and start the workout. And look, like now we have a duration. Then I can add activities as I go. So I could say running, 3.5, add to workout, bench press. Actually, oh, and can I change it to strength? And then I can add different things. I could say bench press, 3, 10, 135, add to workout. And then when I'm done, I can go and say, finish workout, enter calories burned. I guess it's forcing me to do that. I think I would remove that, but for now I'll keep it. And there we go. So we have our workout and I like that a lot better. So quick log is still what we had before, but start workout is this new feature that it just generated. And I like this better. So I'm going to go ahead and publish it. Let's publish the app. But hopefully you're seeing like how easy it is to just in natural language, build out what you want, test it out, come up with, you know, different user interfaces or different features that you want to be more customized to whatever your use case is. This is the kind of thing about vibe coding is you can build anything. So you have to think about your own life, what you wish you had software for. And then that's when you go to Mocha and then start generating it. Now you can also talk with Mocha, you can discuss and kind of go back and forth with your idea to kind of refine it for the app as well. So, and that's another cool use case to do. So now let's go ahead. I published it to our production and we can see that star workout feature is now in our production app, which is cool. Something else you should be aware of is here in Mocha, let's say you change your mind and you actually don't like that feature anymore. You can always revert. So you can undo that feature. And so I'm going to show you what that looks like. I'll undo. Everything's going to be lost, but let's do it just to show you what that looks like. And now here it is no longer there. If I go to the production app, it will still be there until you go and publish again. So that's something that you do need to understand is the way that both the production and development versions of the app, both on the database and the actual front end of the app, are different. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. Leave a comment below to let me know what you think. Thank you again to Mocha for sponsoring this video. Click the link in the description to go to Mocha and start building on your own. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to get even more free content like this, and we'll see you in the next video.